806. Need to Know Morning Show, AM 1100, the flag, WZFG. It's the Need to Know Morning Show rolling into hour number three. Been a heck of a day already, and excited to finish it up with a visit today with some folks that are really one of the big drivers behind community growth in the downtown area. Mike Allmendinger is the main man behind Kilbourne Group. And Mike is somebody that we've known for quite a while. I've had some great visits with him. At Kilbourne Group, and he said, hey, we'll come on over and visit too. And very thankful to also have Adrian Olson here with us in studio this morning. So thank you both for coming over. Good to see you.
Thanks. Good to see you.
Thanks for making some time. Mike, I'll start with you. We see the Block 9 building continue to go up, and we can really start to see the shape now of the building and the scale of that. Right now, it's just kind of beams and girders and a little bit of foundation work, so it doesn't look pretty yet, but you can really tell what kind of an impact that's going to make in that downtown landscape as we start to see now what the shape of that building's going to look like and the dimensions are there for us.
The construction team is doing a great job. They are building and adding one floor about every 8 days right now. There's 160 guys working on that project, and it's just fascinating to watch them be organized. They meet in the morning, and they coordinate what work they're going to be completing for that day. And they break into teams of 3 to 8 people, and they go out and get that work done for the day. And it's a really hardworking group that's focused, focused on safety, focused on, community and neighbors that they're working around and getting a project like this built in our downtown.
Yeah. Adrian, is this something that do you sense that curiosity, excitement, whatever it is you want to call it, do you sense that's growing day by day as progress is made?
Well, I've always had a sense of it, but during the street fair, I got to see it. I got to watch people come to Broadway in the morning before the street fair opened and just stand and stare. And it was just so fun to see the look on people's faces and the expressions that they had, the wows.
Yeah.
And how cool is this? And if you haven't been downtown for a while, it's a pretty sizable building. It's about, right now it's looking comparable to the Radisson. So
yes,
it's fun to see.
Yeah. Are we on pace, Mike? Are things progressing on schedule with the contracting and the development there?
Yeah, the project is on schedule at this point. They lost a little time from this last winter. It was a more challenging winter than most in this last winter. So they've been working quite a few double shifts. You're going to see guys working there Saturdays and Sundays preparing for the next week. So the large crew, when 150 people show up, they can get to work and accomplish what they need to do.
Yeah. Adrian, as communications director for Kilbourne, what are you doing right now to try to keep people thinking about it, kind of keep it in people's minds so that we know the building is going, but there can be a long time with phases where, okay, now the general shell of the building is built and it might seem like, okay, there's not much to talk about for a while. How are you continuing to get information out about what's happening in the building?
Sure. Well, our first priority is our neighbors and making sure they know what kind of impacts are going to be happening downtown. And then as far as just letting everybody know about what's happening, there's so many little stories that happen throughout the building of this. We had people crawl up into the cranes and do some video footage up there and talk about what it's like to be a crane operator. There's just these little stories along the way that we're able to share. And people are generally interested in it and done a few videos.
Yes.
A lot of fun.
Yeah.
Some drone footage. That's always exciting drone footage comes in.
Oh, I'll have to check that out. I haven't seen that, but I bet that would be pretty fun to watch.
Yeah, we put it all on block9fargo.com and try to keep at least something new out there every couple weeks.
Very nice. Mike, so far, has there been, now it's one thing to see a plan and you see the renderings, okay, it looks like this or that might happen. There was, I guess, the one issue with the Prairie Public Broadcasting with the satellite dishes and the directionals and that kind of thing. That got worked through. Has there been anything that's come up where people have said, maybe to you in a way that isn't so glowing, like, oh, I didn't realize it was going to be that or do that? Or has the whole thing been pretty smooth that way as far as the public perception of the project as it's been developing?
During the construction period, I've heard all positive comments about the project, as it comes together, where the plaza is located. People can walk downtown now and really start to envision where the green space is going to be for the plaza. How the office works, and they just have a lot of questions about the project coming together. The parking garage is open right now already, so that's open and available for the public.
Oh, that's great. So you've got this 48,000 square foot parking lot, basically, where there wasn't much going on. And we all remember when we saw the pictures for the first time, you go, wow, that's going to be great. But I think the piece of it that I think is so maybe, I'm looking for the right word, understated or underappreciated or whatever, but the green space, having actual green space there, and then what the city is doing with its renovation of the area where the old city hall used to be, you're going to have two patches of green grass down there. And I think that's going to be a real welcoming piece of this that maybe people don't quite get. We see the building, and yeah, that seems cool, but having that patch of green in there, it seems small, but I really think that's going to be a game changer for the downtown area.
Yeah, having that outdoor program space for the community to, come to celebrate, many different events was going to be really important for downtown Fargo. It's been part of the master plan and the in focus plan for many years. And as projects are coming together and redevelopment is starting, there's going to be opportunities for, this plaza that's happening by Block 9. And as you said, the city of Fargo is considering one by City Hall. Sodbusters going in this fall. So there is more green space that's available for people living in downtown Fargo and working and coming down there for the day to enjoy, many different experiences.
Adrienne, when people ask you, what is Block 9? It's not an easy answer. I know there are so many things that are going to be part of this project. But for those that have forgotten or maybe never really got into the details, what all is going to be part of this project?
Sure. Well, RDO has its corporate headquarters in that building now. So there'll be about 350 RDO team members that come in. So it's an office. There's also going to be first floor retail, the restaurant, and a coffee shop. And then there is a 125-room hotel that's going to be really reflective of our Fargo community. It's a unique hotel, not one like you'll find in any other community.
What makes it unique? What kind of features will it have that's so different?
Sure. So it's not a flag hotel. It's by Aperium Hotel Group, which does boutique hotels in different communities. And what they do is they go into the community and get to know kind of what we're proud of and what we're excited about, some of our historical and cultural stories, and then they bring that into the design of the hotel. Mm. So we're excited about that.
So think more like Hotel Donaldson and less Hilton, maybe.
Exactly.
Yeah, it's kind of got some nuances and niches and kind of local flavor to it there.
Exactly. And then, every community deserves and needs a nice place to sit. So even when there's not programming going down at the plaza, you'll still be able to come and enjoy that space. It's going to be a space for everybody.
Okay. Sounds like a destination.
Absolutely. That's the plan.
Yeah. I mean, currently there's not really a place for all the people that work downtown, which I don't know how many it is, but thousands of people, right? I mean, altogether, for you to grab a sandwich and go sit and be outside and have that cool place to just sit and see the sunshine in the spring, and get outside. There's not really a great place to do that. The U.S. Bank Plaza, they've got a little spot, but it's a lot of concrete. And I think it's just going to be that nice area for people to gather on the weekends to grab their ice cream cone or lunches or whatever. I think that, again, I think that whole thing ties in, but really underappreciated as to what it's really going to be and feel like.
And as a mom, we're going to have a water feature in there that is going to be a magnet for every kid that walks downtown. Everybody's going to want to play in that. Yeah. You throw some public art, some things that make you think, some things that make you enjoy the space.
Very exciting. There's also some housing, right? There's some condos on the...
Yes,
on the upper level?
There's six condos on the top levels, and those are custom condos for the folks who buy them. And
Halstrom wants to reserve a spot there.
I'd like them all, actually. Not sure how realistic that might be, but how are how the sales are of the condos? Are they coming along?
Yeah, four are gone.
Four are sold.
We have two left.
Okay.
Well, there you go. Get your name on the list there.
Wouldn't that be nice? And yeah, Everyone's going to want to know starting price, maximum price, any sort of guesses or any, I'm sure you know, but what are the ranges that you're be looking at to buy that square footage there?
Do you know that answer?
For the two that are left, I would need to check. I believe it's more than $1.5 million. It's okay. Closer to $2 million for those two.
Okay. And are they all about the same, or is there a one bigger one and five smaller ones? How's that go again?
They all have different sizes. That's why I'm not quite sure on the price of the last two that are available.
Gotcha. And four are sold, two are remaining there yet.
That's right.
Okay, so there's still some space available there. Yep. It's 8:16 on the Need to Know Morning Show, AM 1100 The Flag. We're visiting with Mike Allmendinger, president of Kilbourne Group, and Adrienne Olson, communications director. Mike, I want to ask you a little bit about the conversations with Renaissance District TIFs, the tax abatements, the incentives there. It's controversial. Every hearing that comes up now, there's this discussion of, well, do we need to do it? And Tony Gehrig, who I'm thankful that he brings up things that he does, he's trying to watch out for the public money, but he's kind of taken this as sort of a signature thing. And every time it seems like now there's a discussion about a new project, the question comes up, would you do this project if there wasn't the abatement? And can you talk about that conversation? Have we gotten to a point where what points need to be made about the process and how these abatements work that maybe you think aren't being articulated well enough right now?
Yeah, I'd say there's two parts that I'd like to would enjoy covering. First part is there's the pilot program. There's three programs that are available for economic development: the Renaissance Zone, the pilot, and the TIF. When we're working on these projects, when we're doing real estate projects and applying for the for the programs that are available, we believe that every project should should go through the third party review, and they should not receive an incentive unless they won't otherwise move forward. That is very true for all real estate projects. There's another application for projects when they're creating primary sector jobs. They are not completing what they call the but-for test, where they have a third party review to determine, you know, will this project move forward without the incentive. I agree with that. I believe that those companies that are considering, you know, 5-year and 10-year planning for their businesses, you know, they're looking at policies and what the cities can offer, and they're making long-term plans on where they're going to grow their businesses. So it's a different application for them, and there is not a third party that reviews the need for that company to move forward. So again, primary sector applications are different than real estate applications. For real estate applications, that's the only type that we've completed, and we 100% agree that all of those applications should have the third party review to determine the need. Mm. The second part that I would like to cover is when we look at the economic policies that are available for growth, there's really two different policies available. One is the policies that the city has in place to create new subdivisions, and then policies for infill projects. And that's really the important debate that is happening within the community. And we support that process and the community dialogue. We're a part of that. We know that our projects would not be moving forward if they didn't have these policies available.
Altogether, I'm sure you get asked, okay, you're getting, I think the number was $15.5 million in the incentives and the abatements. Do I have that number right, Mike?
Yes.
Does that sound about right?
Yes.
And then overall, in the next, you know, 20, 30 years, what will it generate? How do you answer that question of, okay, that's a lot of money up front. How does the city get it back?
Well, I would start by just clarifying the projects. The city of Fargo is not contributing any money to these projects. These properties are now paying low property taxes, maybe $20,000 a year, because it's just land and it's surface parking lots in those locations. And what these policies provide is, you know, a $20 million project occurs on the project or on the what is now a surface parking lot. We will be paying over $17 million of property taxes between years 1 and 15 with those new projects. So we do start paying property taxes and incrementally pay more each year as the project can, as the project can afford to do that. And that determination is reviewed by a third party that the city of Fargo hires. They have them look at the need for the project and the incentive.
So you could say that it's dollar for dollar. The project is going to pay 17, which is a little bit more actually. 15 will be the incentive. So you could make the case that it's for every dollar that's put in, the city contributes a dollar to get this project built.
Yes, that's one way. And I would say that there's others that would say that there's no incentive offered, because if the project doesn't move forward, there's no property taxes generated except for the $20,000 a year. Mm-hmm. And that is the important critical question is, you know, will the project move forward without the incentive? And it comes down to receiving financing from a bank. And that's, you know, that's our threshold of what we need to work for, is to continue to create projects that are that can receive financing, and that's what that third party reviews.
So maybe we could say, instead of looking at each project one by one and saying, would you do this project? The question maybe should be, will companies like Kilbourne want to continue doing things like this if the overall scenario changes and that money is not available? Is that a fair way to look at it? Don't look at each project individually, but ask, will these kind of projects, will developers want to get into this kind of business in Fargo if it's not there?
Yes, and that's the City of Fargo Tax Exempt Committee had spent about a year reviewing the policies and adopted new policy in February of 2019. And that's the applications that we're submitting for our projects in downtown. And through that process, they, you know, completed the analysis and understand that projects in downtown Fargo will not happen without these in place. And there are many incentives offered for new subdivisions as well. And it's a way to support economic growth. Both of those are very important for the city to keep growing. Mm. And cities across the Midwest offer these as well. But we're, you know, I think over the last 5 to 10 years, we've just seen more growth happening in downtown Fargo. There are more people that want to live in the walkable downtown community. And that's why we're excited to be doing the projects in downtown and keep providing the growth and the projects down there to provide the people or provide that space that people want to be in.
We're visiting with Mike Allmendinger and Adrian Olson, President and Communications Director of Kilbourne Group. We have an email that's come in about this and talking about what did actually have to be taken down in order to put Block 9 up. And so we'll dig into that with Mike and Adrian when we come back on the Need to Know Morning Show.
AM 1100, The Flag, Pledge Allegiance.
All American Plumbing and Heating in Horace wants you to imagine what it's like to be a young person serving in our military overseas. A military care package can comfort a soldier far from home. Call your local veterans organization for information and see how you can get involved. This message is from All American Plumbing and Heating, 709 4th Street East in Horace. Call 356-5325. That's 356-5325. Proud to salute our troops.
The deals are hot at Gateway Chevrolet. Save 25% off new Chevy Silverados. That's savings up to $13,000. That's right, $13,000 off new Chevy Silverados. These Silverados are loaded with heated seats, auto start, OnStar, Apple CarPlay, USB ports, backup camera, rear park assist, and more. Hurry in, the deals are hot with savings up to $13,000 on new Silverados. Only at Gateway Chevrolet. Find new roads. Details, gatewayfargo.com.
AM 1100, The Flag will be on the road this Friday as Scott Hennen will be live at Gate City Bank. Woodhaven location from 11 to 1. Gate City is having a one-day back-to-school event where you can enter to win one of 50 $100 gift cards and earn up to $50 when you switch to Gate City Bank. Also, when you open your new checking account, get your free My School Spirit debit card printed instantly. This Friday, live from Gate City Bank, Woodhaven location from 11 to 1.
The key to a strong home is a solid foundation, and that starts from the ground up. The team at Precision Concrete Cutters Ramjack North wants you to know that around here, seasonal changes cause soil to shift, ultimately leading to serious structural problems. One of the most common signs that your foundation is in need of stabilization is cracking in your walls or flooring. Let us help you protect your greatest asset. To learn more, go to ramjacknorth.com. That's ramjacknorth.com.
Is your post-harvest grain protected from the ravaging effects of stored grain insects? For up to 4 cents per bushel, Diacon D-IGR provides long-term insect control by ending infestations and preventing rebound. MillerCoors, Bush Agricultural Resources LLC, and other malting companies have approved Diacon D-IGR for use by its growers and companies that supply its growers. Help protect your stored grains with Diacon D-IGR. For more information, contact your local dealer or visit bugfreegrains.com.
Bad theater seats, cheap Halloween masks, my apartment, all things with obstructed views. Add to these large trucks and buses. 18-wheelers and large buses have big blind spots and, like my apartment, they don't always have the best view. Bus and truck drivers deal with blind spots around the entire vehicle. always take care not to ride alongside or too close behind them. Our roads, our safety. Learn more at sharetheroadsafely.gov.
You pull into the garage listening to AM 1100 The Flag. Get inside the house and immediately tell Alexa, wave the flag. And the conversation continues.
It's 8:27 on the Need to Know Morning Show. Here's your WZFG three-day forecast. Lots of sunshine today, going up to 73 with a low of 48 and light wind. More sun tomorrow and a little bit warmer, 74. And Friday, we do have a slight chance of rain in the afternoon there, and going up to 77. Right now, 56.
All right, it's 8:27 on the Need to Know Morning Show. Visiting our conversation with Mike Allmendinger and Adrian Olson from the Kilbourne Group. Mike, an email has come into the studio, to the True IT inbox. What did Kilbourne Group have to tear down to put that humongous building up, and how much of a tax break did they get to put the building up? So we answered the tax break earlier, and we said that there's about $15.5 million in abatements, if you will, incentives. There's about $17 million over the first 15 years. The Kilbourne Group and the building, the project itself, is going to pay in. So we talked about that before. But, Mike, specifically, what did you have to tear down to put that building up? Not much, right?
That's right. This location was a surface parking lot that the city of Fargo owned part of it, and the U.S. Bank building owned part of the lot. There were historic buildings in this location originally, and then there was a fire and the buildings were torn down and never rebuilt. So when you're in downtown Fargo, you know, walking and having that walkable experience and going from, you know, going up and down Broadway, it's really critical to have buildings in all of these locations instead of having, you know, large gaps of surface parking lots. The strategy for parking in downtown Fargo has been really important part of the overall development, where they are, the goal is to take these surface parking lots and, you know, create 6 to 7 story garages where you can stack the cars and then build the real estate around them. And these are places where people can live, work, and have retail experiences.
And one of the cool things about this is you've got the parking garages, but they're kind of concealed with all the other things. So it's not just a stacked parking garage. It blends in with everything else. So it's not quite the scene you might get if you were just building a parking ramp. Well, our half hour has flown past. Mike, can we do this again sometime? I feel like we got all the main stuff, but I feel like we're just scratching the surface. Let's do this again sometime.
Yes, would enjoy coming
Love
back.
That.
Okay, thank you for your time. And we'll be watching to see as that thing gets filled in and the glass will be in pretty soon and all those good things will be happening. And completion is fall of next year, right?
Fall altogether? Of 2020.
Okay. It'll be here before we know it, sadly. Yes. Mike and Adrian, thanks for coming in. Thanks to all of you for making us a part of your Wednesday morning here on the Need to